Welcome back, friends, to the shop. Today I've got something very special for you, something that is as rare as a unicorn and that I can't believe that it's actually in my possession. Let me back up a little bit, tell you how I came about this. Now, years ago, when my grandfather passed away, it was the last day I was at his house. I was going through some things, gathering up last minute tools and different things that he had given to me. And I was just getting ready to leave and I thought, you know, I'm gonna go do one more walk around and just double check that I hadn't left something behind. And I went out to the backyard and he had built this old lean-to shed that he'd stored up bark and firewood, different things. He used to sit out there and cut kindling in. And I'd been out there many times before and I walked in and I was just kind of kicking around through some of the pine needles and different things and my foot hit something. Well, we all know the story, or those of you guys who have followed the channel, that's where I found the 1927 Seger chemical in a Puget Sound pattern. Yeah, how about that, huh? Which is, of course, one of my most prized possessions here. And if that wasn't important, good enough, the fact that it was Granddad's axe and that he used it in the woods makes it, well, even more that much more special. That's a very rare bird indeed right there. Probably one of the finest axes ever produced, definitely the high water mark. Well, that wasn't the only thing that I found, but I didn't realize it until recently exactly what I had in my possession, and that's what we have right here. What this is a Halsbrook, a Swedish double-bitted axe, which is a traditional American pattern of a felling axe that is nearly unused. When I found this, he must have, I don't know where these came from, or I don't have any history on this one at all, but when I was, he must have had acquired them somehow and kind of threw them in the back of the shed, maybe intending to put handles on them one day, and they had basically almost got buried. Had I not went in there and kicked around and found them, it would have been completely lost to me. This one here was also, there were three of them in there. This was what the condition was. I have had this, both of these, for quite some time now, and on a whim, I was cleaning out some stuff and I came back across it. I threw these in the evaporust, and when I pulled it out, I couldn't believe my eyes. Let's take a close look and I'll show you and tell you a little bit about this and why it's so special. Let's get a close up of this little gem right here. Boy, that's so rare, I've never even seen one. I've read about them, Swedish double-bit axes, but to get one in this condition that hasn't been abused, oftentimes you'll see these things, I guess probably maybe in the 70s and 80s and stuff when everything pretty much went to mechanical or electrical gas-powered equipment. These things were just seen as antiquated, and a lot of them just basically became doorstops or anvils. You'll see, even on Granddad's chemical, there had some chips and dings there where someone had used it almost like an anvil. But this one is just absolutely pristine. You can see there, it's even got the original color, which we'll talk about that here in just a minute. But check that out. Look at the maker's mark. There we have the traditional HB, the Swedish crown, Halsbrooks, made in Sweden. The maker's mark right there. And flip over to the other side, we can see that that's a 3.5 pounder. Just perfect, perfect for a double bit. Now, one thing that's kind of really cool about the using the evaporust when you're restoring these old tools is it brings out, gives you a little bit of, you can kind of see behind the curtain there a little bit. Now, on your double bitted axes, how they would have been used back in the day, they have two very different edges ground on them. We'd have what we'd call maybe the keener edge, the falling edge, which would be this side here, and they would have the brushing or the limbing edge. If you look there real closely, you'll see a delineation in the steel. You see where you have that dark gray color and then lighter there, and then also over here on this side, we've got that dark gray color. That's the temper. That's the hardness. That's where it's been hardened right there so that it's to hold an edge. Now, these were ground very differently for a reason. A guy would go out into the forest, you have to remember that this tool, whether it be this or a crosscut saw, it was how the guy made his money. Oftentimes, guys would go out into the forest in pairs, and they got paid by production. They got paid by the tree. So if you went out there and spent a 12-hour shift, with a poor fitted axe or one that didn't have a good handle on it, it wasn't sharp, that was money out of your pocket. So they were real particular about these and making sure that they were well cared for. So the edge that they would have wanted to use to actually do the falling, where it had to be hair-popping razor sharp, they would have really protected. They would have never used that anywhere near maybe bark, which will hold a lot of sediment and gravel and dust, which will dull an edge of an axe or a saw. They would have protected that. And then the other side, they would have ground it a little bit more bluntly, and that would have been more the utility edge. So if they needed to cut limbs, which can be really hard, and you know, fir limbs that have a lot of sap in them and resin, they can actually chip an axe, a really good one. They were totally ground separate. So you can see right there, in the folks that made this, they understood that. See how much more you have right there, much more of treated material. Now there's a lot of room there to grind. As you're over the years, as you use it, you're filing and filing, you know, you can go a long ways and this axe's head is still serviceable. And this one here is a lot less. And I don't know for sure, but I would assume, we can check the angles here, but I'm sure I'm right. This should be ground at about a 25 degree. This is just a brass angle checker right there. So this should have been ground at about a 25 degree, and that's exactly what it is. You can see right there. 25 degree and then a 30 on the other end, a little bit broader. And you can see, yep, that's exactly right. That's just so cool. You know, you read about it and you hear, you know, read the stories from the old timers, how they did things. And then you find something like this and indeed that's almost brand new and you can kind of, what they were saying was absolutely true. When I originally put this in the evaporust, I didn't think twice about the color. I didn't even really notice it. It had so much rust and dirt stuff on it. But when it came out and there was so much of the blue left, I thought, boy, how cool would it be to if I could find that original color, and when we restore this, to go back to the exact pattern. And I didn't have any way of finding that paint, so I went down to my local paint store, Benjamin Moore, and they have pretty amazing technology now where they can basically take a machine and they take a photo of this, and they can reverse that reverse engineer that color back to the original. So this is what I came up with. I haven't seen it yet, so I thought we'd take a look at it together and see how close they got. If you want that color, maybe you can see that right there. I don't know. You can ask me if it's important to you. I could get that to you. But you can take those codes and then they can match that up. But let's take a sample here. Oh, that looks pretty close there. Looks pretty close. Here, while we're chit-chatting, we'll put a little sample on there next to it. And that's a good match right there. Now I can see it's a little bit off, but that's probably because it's wet. So once that dries here in a little bit, I think we're gonna be in good shape. Well, that's drying. I wanted to give you a little demonstration of the quality of the steel. There's just nothing like Swedish steel. It's about as good as it gets. You've heard the term, there's a ring of truth of something, or the ring of truth. Well, where that came from was, you could tell right away how pure a piece of steel is, what the quality of it is, by the resonation, by the vibration that travels through it that we can hear. If you take a piece of like a pig metal or cast iron, something of very low quality, and you hang it by a string like this and you strike it, all it does is just make a dead thud. But a piece of steel that's been refined and that is very pure and forged and really nice will have a certain ring to it. Listen to this. Still, that tone. Listen how long it rings. That's a high quality piece of steel. It rings true, as they would have said in the old days. It's not completely dry, but it's fading in there nice. That's a pretty good match right there. I'm really happy with that. That's gonna look really nice. Today's video is gonna kick off a little mini series. We'll do a full restoration on this from start to finish. We'll custom make a Tennessee flat sawn hickory handle. We'll do the whole thing all traditionally and bring this back to a condition that was even better, way better than it was brand new, and keeping true to the original pattern on it. I'm glad that paint was on there. I don't know how I would have got that color otherwise. But I want to jump on this today, but we had a little water spillage in the house, and we're in there replacing a little bit of wood that got messed up, so I got to go focus on that today. It's probably not something to be too super interesting for you guys, but tomorrow, bright and early, we'll jump in on this and we'll put the grind on it. We'll get it painted, and while that's setting up, we'll go pick out a custom or a special piece of hickory for it. We'll do all of that, and I think you'll enjoy it. It's been some time since we've done an axe from scratch. People ask why I don't do more of them. It's because, boy, they're a ton of work. You know, to build an axe handle, a double-bitted axe handle like this from scratch, from a piece of quarter or five-quarter flat sawn hickory, is about a 10-hour job, and that's plus the videoing of it and all that. So it does take a little time, not something I can just do in one video. So we probably have a little extra time. It's been several days since we've been into this little book. Let's go over to the stove and we'll finish up with the manly manners. You guys got time for manly manners here, don't you? We'll do a short one here. All right, manly manners tells us, don't neglect seeing your wife off or meeting her on a return from a journey on the grounds that she is so capable that she doesn't need you. Perhaps not, but she would like to see you all the same. Now that's a good man. That's a manly manners I can get behind. One thing that Mrs. W does that has meant so much to me, and one time she didn't do it, and I didn't realize how much it meant to me, and I told her, I'm like, that really made me sad you didn't do this, was that always be excited or make an effort when you come home. Even if it's just, if you're just gone a couple hours, she's always been really good to greet me at the door, making sure that the kids are up and everyone is excited. You know, it's almost as if you've been gone from a long trip. It feels good when you come home and just to know that you've been wanted and that you've been missed and that everyone is excited to see you. And I try to make a special point to that. When I hear, of course, you know, the dogs are always barking. It's not hard to figure out when someone's pulling in the driveway. So I know when she comes home, it doesn't matter what I'm doing or how busy I think I am or how important my work is. I try to stop and get up out of my chair and go there and greet her at the door. Make sure the kid's there. And just as a way of just showing love and respect. And she kind of started that. And I realized how much it meant to me. And I've reciprocated that. It's a little thing that you can do that just means a lot. Even if she just goes to the store, just make sure that you take a moment and to do that. She also, you know, things like the airport. I'm a very observant people. I've always been a maybe what you call a watcher. I watch people and how they act and behave. It's almost like a hobby to me in public spaces. And I have witnessed this at airports where you have people deplaning or getting off the plane. And I remember one time specifically, there was a Hispanic family, and there must have been five or six kids, and the grandparents were there. And it looks like, you know, members of the family had been on a vacation, and they'd come back. And they had went to the trouble of, they had balloons, and they had made these posters and all that. And it was, you know, it was so delightful to see that and the joy that brought to those, to the family members that were coming home after a long trip. You could see the envy in the eyes of the other people that were coming off board that had no one to meet them there. You know, and there's not always an opportunity to do that. If you're a business traveler, I mean, you can't expect everyone to do that for you all the time. But when you have it within your ability to do it, it means a lot. Someone said something in the comments, I'll close with this, yesterday on the video of teaching the Sweet Loaf to ski, about how nice it was to see the family, her being the center of attention of the entire family, meaning Jack and Mrs. W and myself, and giving that admiration and that praise and that acknowledgement for showing courage and, you know, into doing something that is new or doing something extraordinary or even extra, you know, doesn't have to be extraordinary. It's important that makes sure that everyone in the family knows that even if they're not the big star, you know, if they're not the one that wins the race all the time, make sure you find something that is praiseworthy in that family member and make sure that the family makes that individual, make sure everyone has their time in the sun, right? And you highlight those achievements and just so you know, just so everyone knows that they're wanted and loved. It's something, I think it's when you have a little one like the Sweet Loaf, she's two now, and that takes so much attention from the family. You got to be careful with the older kids. You know, Jack is 14, coming up on 15 now. He's becoming a young man. You know, he doesn't require as much attention and such as a little one does. But you can you can get to the point where you can focus so much of your effort and time on the little ones that require it and leave out the accomplishments and the needs of the older ones too. So be careful with that. Make sure that everyone has their day in the sun and that the family rewards or shows appreciation for everything that is done. Because I'll tell you, just because one, maybe the man is the bread earner, goes out and earns the living for the family, that doesn't make his role more important than his wife who stays at home and raises those kids and homeschools and all that. And to be honest, it's probably harder to stay at home and be stuck with those things. It's definitely harder, I think. I don't know that I could do Mrs. W's job, but I think she could probably do mine. So that's it for Manly Manners. Keep us in your prayers. May God bless you and your families. We'll see you guys on the next video, and tomorrow we'll get started with the ultimate double bit axe restoration.
If you see me getting smaller, I'm leaving, so don't be grieving. I just gotta get away from here. If you see me getting smaller, don't worry, I'm in no hurry. I got the right to disappear.